biodiversity and through fermentation we can do that. And by doing that, we also change the landscape of what farms look like, because if we all eat more diverse foods, that translates to demand on the farms, and the farmers also start growing more biodiversity, which makes our farms much more resilient to climate change and make the farms healthier. So that's what we do.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Winnie Mailu. I work for a charity called Ripple Effect. We work in 6 countries in Africa, including Kenya. We work with smallholder farmers in all these countries, our objective being supporting them to ensure their food secure and to also have better livelihood. And our agriculture work is very agroecologically driven. We believe there are better ways of putting food on the table without using lots of chemicals and fertilizers. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Betty Bundotich. I am the managing director of Kilifi Plantations. That is the farm that you see when you drive as you come to Kivukoni School. We are a mixed farm, so we rear animals. We have dairy animals, beef, goats, and sheep. We also grow vegetables regeneratively for the local market. Like Queenie has said, we are great believers in soil health and doing everything in our farming practices that supports that objective of keeping the soils healthy so that it can grow healthy food, which we sell and make healthy people and a healthy community.
Thanks. Good afternoon. I'm not sure if you can hear me. My name is Tendai Mtana, and I am the founder of Mwerekera Conservancy. I work with the community, and having been born in Kilifi, having understood what and how we live around food, I've spent the last 10 years working in food systems in various government roles, but now spending time helping the community reorganize land and how they govern land in order to make it productive. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much, Kivukoni School, for giving us this noble opportunity to be amongst the panelists today. My name is Mohamed Salim. I'm the founder of Migombani Organic Farm, which is based in Kambala, Kilifi County. We do organic farming practice, including permaculture and also syntropic agroforestry system. We also integrate our syntropic agroforestry with aquaculture, which actually gives more nutrients to the plants and the soil. And we are very proud to announce that we have been shortlisted as among the best fish farmer competition in April 2024, having been able to, it was actually the first award coming from Kilifi County. So I'm here to also share my ideas and also with my colleagues here, how we can secure food security in Kilifi County. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. My name is Jyoti Fernandez. I'm a farmer in England, so it's very far from here. And I don't know how you'll be food secure here, but I can share my ideas of what we're doing in England towards food security. And I also work with a small farmers organization representing 200 million peasant farmers around the world. And I've been visiting here in Kenya some Ripple Effect project with Winnie, who's here, and also visiting the Kenyan Peasant League, who are fighting for the rights of small-scale farmers, because the organization I work for, we've looked at the statistics around the whole world and seen that 80% of global food security comes from smallholder farmers. So I think it's really important that food security here is based on smallholder farmers that are farming naturally in harmony with the environment. And I wanted to share that real pride in being a farmer here with all of you today.
Fantastic. Wow, what an amazing panel, right? This is so amazing to have such diversity here and to look at food from so many different perspectives. So I think this is a great opportunity for us all to learn, certainly for myself and I think probably everybody here. So I'd love to kick things off with a question to Tendai on what is the food and ecosystem history of the land in Kilifi and in the coast? And what clues could that give us about food security and how this land could be farmed, could produce food? So what is the history of this land?
Sorry. Thank you. Ooh, okay, so I think the fundamental genesis would be family. Family as custodians of the land. And I think if we start there, what we would then be able to do is have a lens through which we could go back in time. So first, the community, let me speak primarily on the Kilifi side, which would predominantly be with the seven tribes of the Mijikenda, with the Digos and the Durumas being on the south coast, but the rest of the seven being on the north coast. And when you look at the seven Mijikenda tribes, you essentially are looking at a clan-based family structure that has been a community of hunters and gatherers. And so that's a fundamental lens through which to look at how the land and what custodial responsibilities they've had. Through history, you won't be able to speak about Kilifi if you didn't speak about, and it's a controversial topic, but it has to be spoken about. You've got to speak about what was historically called the 12-mile strip, which essentially means 12 miles from the ocean up towards the hills. And essentially what you had was plantations all along the entire coastal strip, and with the hunters and gatherers moved back. And so from a land use perspective, what you have seen is you don't really have a culture of food production. And so a lot of what we've seen now has been a case of monkey see, monkey do. And a lot of what we've seen recently is a monoculture around imported food. So you have your maize, which is a very recent crop in terms of carbohydrates. You found everyone assumes that because we live by the coast that, you know, we're a good fishing community, which we are. And so source of protein would be considered the ocean. However, you do still find that protein is in itself not a diet that is consumed up towards beyond the 12-mile strip. And so you do have a vegetable diet, but that's again of indigenous vegetables, which again more recently has been, again to the controversial points that I keep adding, a substitute based on taste. And so you tend to find that we would prefer the more quote-unquote palatable vegetables of whether it's skumawiki or cabbage, and less with the more indigenous greens.
Sure. So thank you, Tendai, for that. And now I'd just love to pass over to Mohammed to speak a little bit about the ecosystem history of this land. So it's my understanding that this coast was a huge forest, right? And so can you talk a bit about syntropic agroforestry and the role that maybe that plays in going back to the history of this land being a forest and that as a potentially more food secure system? Is my understanding right that this was all a forest, and so why syntropic agroforestry for you?
Thank you so much. First and foremost, when you talk about historically, the coast, having been born here in Kilifi, we have been blessed with a very natural ecosystem. It's just that I'm sorry to say that through human interruptions, that's why we have gone where we have reached where we are now. But syntropic agroforestry is a climate smart sustainable farming model, which was started by a gentleman called Ernest Gosch from Brazil, and it has actually has a very success stories, which includes soil building, because currently most of our farmers, the local farmers, have been using a lot of chemical inputs that has in the long run depleted the soil fertility. So what we are talking about now is how we can build the soil so that we can have a better product or produce to our families.
Thanks, Mohammed. Would it be okay for you to just explain, maybe for those of us here who don't know, what is syntropic, just briefly, what is syntropic agroforestry? What does that look like to a non-farmer?
Well, briefly, syntropic agroforestry is a system that mimics the forest, how the forest is. It has different layers. It has different layers in terms of medium, large shrubs, so that when it comes to the sunlight, the succession of planting, whereby each plant takes a different scale and time to grow, so that in a, let's say, 5 square meter land or garden, you can harvest diverse crops in a very small specific area, where you have timber, at the same time you have fruit trees, at the same time you have vegetables, and at the same time you have also ground covers like sweet potatoes and all that.
Fantastic, thank you so much. So I'd just also love to hand over to Betty to talk a little bit about what your vision for a food secure Kilifi would look like. Where are we trying to get to with all of this work with syntropics, with Tendai looking at family and clan and the Mariah Carey Conservancy, you know, to combine, and Betty with Amazing Grove and Meadow and Winnie, with all of these efforts, what does a food secure Kilifi look like to you?
Thank you. I think I'll go back to what both Tendai and Mohammed have said, where we try and refer to what the historical food growing system was. I think monoculture, which is what a lot of people think is modern agriculture, the growing of one crop in one area over and over again every year, first of all, it depletes the soils of the organic matter. It depletes the soils of any nutrients that are necessary for, you know, for the successful growing of crops. But not only that, it has been proven scientifically that a monoculture system compared to a polyculture, where polyculture is where you grow several things together in one area, has 6,000 more calories per unit area compared to a monoculture. So for me, my vision is where we try and get the communities to understand the damages that monoculture does, number one. Number two, go back to introducing what I call the orphan crops, you know, the millets and the bambara bean, the sorghum, all the crops that our forefathers used to feed their families, which were more calorie intense, at the same time were not so depleting of the soils. If we can find a way of slowly, over time, training, especially the smallholder farmers, because they have the land and the labor within the family to make it possible not to use chemicals. The use of fertilizers and pesticides is actually one of the main reasons why our harvests are not as good as they ought to be, despite what we are told that fertilizer and pesticides will improve yields. It may at the first time when you plant, but over time it actually depletes any yields that you get out of that land. So go back to polyculture, wean off, because we can't just stop overnight, wean off the monoculture system that we currently use, and involve the communities as well as the government in training the farmers to do the right thing.
Thank you so much, Betty. That's really energizing and very clear, some clear points for us there. So Delia, for you, you know, coming from a different perspective, not so much necessarily the farming, but from a business perspective, what does a food secure system look like to you, and how have you thought about that from Grover Meadow and Browns?
Yeah, so we run a big dairy business, and when I'm with all my farmers, we were discussing the milk, and they said to me, thank you very much for paying me on time, because I take that money to buy chemicals for my potato blight, so that I get a potato crop. And that really frustrated me, and food is connected, so I might be working in dairy, but those farmers are no better off because they're taking the money I give them and spending it on chemicals. So that's how Grove and Meadow started, because I got really frustrated that sort of all my efforts were not improving their lives. And so as a food processor, we really sit on a value chain. I think we all think very linearly, and we have to think like nature in this, in a different way. And everything is connected. So as a food processor, we sit where we can affect farmers and we can affect human health. So if you see our stand there, you'll see you can eat a cowpea cookie that I made. So that's not just a cookie. If you took it and ate it, you would think it was just a cookie, but it's full of cowpeas. Cowpeas grow traditionally at the coast. So are there ways with food processing that you can incorporate and create demand and stimulate demand so that farmers grow these crops? Because telling a farmer just to grow cowpeas and grow bambara nuts and grow sorghum because it's good for their soil and good for them doesn't create change. What farmers understand is economy. It has to make sense financially. And so can you stimulate that change on that farm by driving demand for ingredients that are forgotten, as Betty said? So that's the angle that we come from, is create the demand side, which will lead farmers to create change on the farm, and suddenly the farm is a different place. And I have farmers that supply me with sorghum and millet, and when their maize crop fails, I don't tell them to not grow maize, but when their maize fails, they're eating the sorghum and millet that they grew for me, and they suddenly realize, oh, I actually have food. So it's not only just a cash crop, it also initiates change for the farmer communities, where they see that they can be more reliant on those old crops.
Did you want to add something there, Betty? Yes, or your hand quicker?
As she talked about when the maize crop fails and you then have the so-called orphan crop to turn to, it just reminded me of something that I thought I ought to bring to the attention of everybody here. And Tendai, we've had this conversation before. This year in Kilifi, we had crop failure. We all know that our rains were not as good as they ought to be. And we lost quite a lot of acreage of maize that we grow for our cows. And at some point, Tendai got in touch with us to see whether we could help the farmers by buying off their maize crop, which wasn't going to yield any grain, to convert it into a silage. Unfortunately, we didn't because of logistics. But what I wanted to bring to your attention is the fact that as the maize crop was failing, we alongside were planting what we call forage sorghum and millet. And I think most of you must have seen some green crop growing, and some people may think that it's actually irrigated. It isn't. It is sorghum and millet, which although the maize crop failed, these succeeded. There's a story right there for us. We should be concentrating on developing those crops, especially with climate change issues coming along.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. So I think now we should really look more and drill down into food security in Kilifi and why it is insecure. Because my understanding is that a huge proportion of the food coming to Kilifi specifically is actually coming from upcountry, a lot from the Nanyuki region, and then it's coming down by truck to Kongowea market in Mombasa, where it's then taken up the coast to what are called local markets. But my understanding is that actually a lot of the food in these so-called local markets has actually come from a very long way away. So if we could really understand that, because that seems to me like it's the issue there is also traceability. There's no traceability on that food. Is it organic? Is it full of pesticides? Where's it come from? There's no relationship to the farmer. But also, what about the small-scale local farmers? And where is their marketplace? Because it's clearly being dominated by people from a long way away. So I wonder, Winnie, with your experience from across all these different countries in East Africa that you're working in and with Ripple Effect, what do you think are the factors
that might be contributing, maybe the other factors that feed into food insecurity in Kilifi? What are we battling with this issue?
Thank you. I think the issues are really, really big, and I would like to mention three, starting right from policy. That, in fact, we are dealing with a big sector whose current development is based on a very, very old foreign way of doing things when it comes to agriculture. And for the longest time, we are trying to copy. So during the colonial periods, what happened is that this country was demarcated to high potential and low potential. And that was already done, and it determined infrastructure. For example, when you look at major milk cooling plant, I know because Browns, you're in the dairy value chain, you'd not find the major milk processing plants in the so-called low potential areas. So even in terms of policy and kind of, dissecting the country in those small pieces, what happened is that there was just marginalization right from the start. And that determined how expertise was also distributed along. Then you'd find the veterinary, the best veterinary offices, the best vet doctors, the best extension people. They were taken to places that would grow the high value crops. And those crops, most of them were not food. It was coffee, it was tea and cotton and sugar. So our food security issues start right from there. And what I see when I walk around Kilifi, because my charity organization is also working in Kilifi, is a lot of sisal. We cannot eat sisal. We actually need families to grow food. So that for me right there is also an issue in terms of, for us, getting back to the basics. I like what Tendai said about, we actually had a way of doing things, and we need to come back to that. And I was in another session in that forum where they are talking about, we all have a responsibility to go back and start telling those stories to our children so that they bring back the system that is failing and the system that is dying. The other thing I really wanted to talk about is the cultural kind of issues that affect the communities we serve. I work for a charity, and one of the things that I must say is that communities that were in the low potential areas, they almost survived on handouts or food aid. And I think for some reason, they were like condemned to that system. So they didn't want to grow. And therefore, as part of the work we are doing is going back to communities and telling them that you have the land. One of my colleagues, he would have a t-shirt. One of our mantra is every food you need starts from an African farm. And as long as you have farm, you can transform it. Whether it's sandy or not, you can transform the soil structure on your backyard and grow food. So that's kind of the second thing that I wanted to talk about, in terms of there is a whole culture change that we need to start inculcating into our children now. We even want to...
because there's a lot of power in the companies that sell these inputs. So that's things like fertilizers that are made out of nitrogen, nitrate fertilizers, herbicides, which kill off the weeds, and pesticides, which kill off pests.
There you go.
Hello?
Ah, yes. Go back.
So all of those things, they were promoted by these big companies as a way to feed the world. And whenever I go to international talks, I go to a lot of meetings that are held by the United Nations where they talk about how we're going to feed the world. You can always see that these companies send out a lot of people dressed really smart, really flashy, trying to promote how they're going to feed the world with these kind of chemicals. And they end up getting a lot of financial support by the global community to be able to push these chemicals. But a lot of people who've been working very hard to try and figure out what's the causes of having climate change. Why are so many of the insects on our planet dying? Why are the bees dying off? Why are we losing all these beautiful animals that are part of our ecosystem? They're realizing that's because of these agrochemicals. And now it's important to try and raise awareness across everyone, you know, from everyone who eats food, basically, from children to elderly to people in schools to people everywhere, that that kind of chemical agriculture isn't really the solution for feeding everyone. But there's a lot of pressure out there, you know, from these companies that say this is how we feed the world. And also there's a whole process where after colonialism, that people carried on in the parts of the world where they were getting money from taking land and resource because of all the crops that were being grown in other places. That process has carried on where you still have companies investing in big farms that use these chemicals that grow big monocultures to be able to ship this food all around the place. You know, it can be across East Africa, it can be across, you know, regions of the world, or it can be international where there's crops being grown in Kenya that are being flown even to places like the UK where I live. And that kind of global food system is a really difficult one to fight, because the people that are promoting the global food system are the people that have the money, because they've been benefiting from this financial flow of money for centuries now. And so, you know, all of these things is a wider context that makes it very difficult at the grassroots level, at the farm level, at the village level, to actually have a different way of growing our food and distributing our food. It determines what we eat, because there's so much pressure there in advertising, in economics, that make it difficult. But what I also see when I go around the world is that there's so many people waking up to this and building a lot of people power, right? And that is such an important thing to have faith in and believe in, because I see it having an impact. The more young people, especially, that understand that healthy food grown organically, food that is local, is important, then the more you can start to change that awareness so that all the people with their flashy suits and their flashy ideas aren't the ones that take all the money. And so I think what I wanted to promote is that we all act together to try and form direct connections with the farmers who are trying to grow the old crops, who are trying to go organically and to sell locally, and support them as much as we can, but also educate ourselves politically to have an influence.
Epic. Okay, we're short on time. So what I'm gonna do is just ask each panelist to give, in a nutshell, something that each person here listening can take away as a really nuggety action point for normal people, for us people in all these different positions. What can we do to help food security in Kilifi? One sentence, not a big ramble. Okay,
so food security is not just nutrients, it's actually nutrient density. We have to eat 40 carrots today to get the same nutrients as one carrot 40 years ago. Just think about that. 40 carrots to get the nutrients of one carrot. It ends with soil health and starts with soil health. Thank you.
My message is, if you live in Kilifi, within this area, just know that outside of these gates, there's somebody today who will not eat anything. They're going to sleep hungry, and therefore the biggest thing is ask yourself, what can I do? Is it about buying that local orange, local mango, rather than buying the exotic that you're finding in Quick Mart? Think about that. Thank you.
My message is share the knowledge. For those of us who are practitioners, it is our public duty to pass the knowledge that we have on soil health to as many people as possible.
Food security is not a global issue. It's not a national issue. It's not a county issue. It's a household issue. We all come from households. And if what we do is recognize that what I have a responsibility to do is to feed myself and my family healthy food, we will be food secure. If that becomes the advocacy, then all of us here will actually be food secure. No one's coming from the outside to make us food secure.
Just to add on what my colleague here has contributed, I think food security in Kilifi has to start with the children. We should teach our children how to grow their own food. For instance, I would pose a question to some of us, like most of us would say my grandfather or my grandmother used to be a farmer. How many of us would say my dad is a farmer? How many of us would like to say, maybe we'll be proud to say my dad is a farmer or something like that? So there's that generational change that needs to be inculcated into our household and family. Let's try our level best to teach our children how to grow food so that this can come back again to where it has started. I'm proud to say that Kivukoni School has been visiting Migombani Organic Farm for the educational tour, and you are all welcome to visit our farm, where you learn, including we have a set up curriculum. So thank you so much for this opportunity.
There was a nice song that I was just listening to that someone from the Kenyan Peasant League was singing to me yesterday. It said, "No farmers, no food, we are the farmers. No farmers, no food, we are the farmers." And I thought it was so wonderful. Just being proud of farmers, supporting your local farmers, getting to know them, making those connections, uplifting the livelihood of farmers, that's what you can do.
Wow, okay. So can we give all these amazing panelists a big round of applause for such an insightful panel? Thank you all so much for coming. That was really epic. And we're